Right before we jump into this video, if you'd like me to send you this free guide to capturing motion in low light situations, just look for this orange box over on the website, put your name, email address in it, hit send it, and I'll send you that guide for free. Jared Polin, FroKnowsPhoto.com, and this is a review of Canon's RF 100 2.8 macro lens. That's right, it's the RF version, meaning it will work on your RF mount. Now, we took this out to Longwood Gardens. Now, when I say we, I mean Steven went along with me. I was using the 105 macro from Nikon, and Steven was using the Canon 100 2.8 macro at Longwood Gardens. So he was finding different textures, finding different landscapes, different things to get macro shots of, and Longwood Gardens is a great place to go because you have flowers, you've got bees flying around, bzzz, bzzz, bzzz. They're flying around, you've got landscapes, the meadows, a lot of great things. Plus, it was fun to get out and shoot with Steven because we haven't done that in quite a while. But let's take a look around the outside of the lens. You've got your lens hood, of course, and you've got your control ring. Here's your control ring. There is no lock for that. That's for controlling your aperture, your ISO. You could set that. I honestly set it to zero, to nothing. I don't want it to do anything. But one of the first things that you notice when you pick it up, it's not terribly too heavy, but it's also not terribly too light. It is a nice feeling lens. There's really not much else to say about it. On the side, we've got some switches. You've got your focus limiter right there. You have your AF to manual, as well as your stabilization on and off, because this lens has IS. Now, when you pair this lens with the R5 or the R6, you're gonna get up to 8 stops of image stabilization and handhold ability, which is a ton of stabilization. Or if you're using the EOS R or the RP, which don't have image stabilization built in, you're gonna get 5 stops. Now, there is another switch over here that says lock. What are we locking? Is it that show called Lost that had one of the worst endings in the history of endings? Maybe, but no. This is what controls SA. This is SA control, which stands for what, Steven?
Spherical aberration.
That's right, SA control. Now, what is this and why is it here? One, I don't know why it's here, but we tested it out at 2.8 wide open, and when you go negative on the SA, this is what it looks like. It gives you a much softer looking everything, which is not very good unless you're making an 80s rock video or an 80s ballad video. And then if you go the other way when you're at 2.8, it's supposed to harden the bokeh in the background. It didn't do too much, but we also went to F8 to stop down to see what it would do, and that's where the effect was more prevalent. So when you go negative, you see how that looks right here, but when you go all the way to the positive side, and it is hardening things a little bit. But my question is, where are you actually going to use this? In our everyday shooting of this, taking it out to Longwood Gardens and then me shooting it back here at the studio of the typewriter, it just doesn't make any sense. And talking to some other photographers that have the lens, it doesn't make much sense to them either. Hey, Canon, why is that even in here? Maybe we could have saved a few bucks by not putting it in there and the lens would have been less expensive. But anyway, I digress. We've got a 67 millimeter lens cap, which means you have a 67 millimeter filter thread, and that is really it for the outside of the lens. Now, it weighs in at 1.6 pounds or 730 grams, which makes it less heavy than the older EF version, which is this right here. That's the EF version with the RF adapter on it already. Wow. So you have to decide, do you want the super old lens, that's the EF, the one version they made, or do you want to go with a newer version for the RF mount? We'll get to that at the end of this video as well when I help you decide who this lens is for. Now, I gave Steven full rein here to shoot whatever he wanted to shoot, as well as process it as he saw fit. So these are not my edits, they're Steven's edits, and I bet he used some FroPak presets on it. Is that correct, Steven?
Yes, sir.
Anyway, so this is the first shot. He loved pointing out textures. He's like, that's a nice texture. Oh, that's a good texture. I'm like, Steven, then why don't you shoot the texture? If you think it's a nice texture, why don't you shoot it? And that's exactly what he did. So he got some nice colors out of this. It is super sharp, super nice, and it feels really good. Now, I know this because I also shot with this lens because I can't review something I haven't actually used, but these are Steven's photos right here. This is stepped back. and it's the door opening, and the detail focus right on the hinge of the door looks incredible. It gives it this super old, muted feel to it, and it looks good. Nice and sharp, and that's great. Let me jump in here real quick because I want to show you this photo taken with the Canon 100mm macro and edited with FroPak 3. Let's start with Fifth Element. Wow, that gives it a really nice effect. Then we've got Canadian Tuxedo, which surprisingly looks really nice to me, followed by Gotham People, which you think would be for people, but if you want something creative, you can do that with one click. Then we've got King Contrast, which really looks good. And then if you want kind of a normal edit, we've got Prestige Worldwide. Now, from FroPak 1, I want to show you something called Skittles. Look at what Skittles does. Now, in this case, it's a little bright, but it's awesome for landscapes. All I need to do is just drag back, and I think it is basically perfect. So if you're looking to speed up your RAW workflow or give yourself a great starting point, we created 15 all-new custom Lightroom presets that you can check out right now at FroKnowsPhoto.com/FroPak3. While you're over there, you can play with the sliders to see the befores and the afters, and if you decide that they're for you, they are currently on sale. Or if you want to grab Skittles in FroPak 1, you can get the FroPak Triple Play Bundle with FroPak 1, 2, and 3 at a special discounted price. Now, let's get back to the video. Now, moving on to the cacti area, we've got this shot that Steven did. It kind of looks like one of those monsters with teeth that they're gonna eat you or something in one of those movies. But let me talk to you about the minimum focus distance. You can go up to 10.2 inches from the subject. Now keep in mind, that's 10.2 inches from the sensor itself. Because there's times I'm like, I'm much closer than 10.2 inches. I know what 10.2 inches is. I've held 10.2 inches before. Don't ask whose it was or what it was, but I've definitely done it. So it's 10.2 inches from here to the subject, not from the end of the lens. I kind of wish it was from the end of the lens because that's just easier. I'm like, wait a second, I'm like 3 inches away, but whatever. Look how nice and sharp this is. Oh my God, that is great. Oh yeah, and Steven used the R5 to get these photos. Moving on, we have another cacti shot, which is super sharp and kind of funny. When you zoom in here, it's like one of those sand people from Star Wars. It's like, or is it a Jawa? Or are they the same thing as a sand people? Or is it an Ewok? It's not an Ewok. But look at that. That looks incredible. And another thing to mention here is that this one has a 1.4 time max magnification, not 1:1. With the Nikon, you have 1:1. With the old Canon, you have 1:1 magnification. Here, you have 1.4x magnification, which is, it brings you in closer. So that looks good. Next, just look at that. You got the, I love the colors that he pulled out of here. I'm not sure what preset it is. It may be Capone, if I had to guess. That looks really nice. Look at those needles. I do not want to touch one of those because we have plenty of those needles outside of the factory. Next, it looks like we moved out to the meadows to take some photos. The meadows are great. If you ever go to Longwood Gardens, they encourage you to bring your camera. You can even bring a tripod. You can set up, just don't step on any flowers. Don't go out of line. Don't do anything stupid. And you can just be there all day taking photos any which way you want because they love when you do that. So it's worth it. It's like 25 bucks to go, spend all day, get some lunch, and it looks great. This one is very light and airy, not my exact style of edit that I would do. It's very much a wedding style, but it is sharp and the background does look fantastic. Now that's probably because it has 9 bladed aperture, 9 rounded blades, supposed to give you a nice bokeh in the background, but I'm just letting you know it has 9 blades and I don't care. Give me 0 blade apertures. I want 0 aperture blades, 0. Then I'd be wide open all the time. Continuing with the meadows, just because you have a macro lens doesn't mean you can't shoot other things with it. You can use the 100 macro to do portraits if you would like. You could use it to do landscape type photos, just like this one. So this is the farmhouse that sits up on the hill. You walk there, it's like a 2 mile loop. So you get there about a mile. You can walk all the way back through the meadows, taking different trails. It's great, it's fantastic. And that's a cool shot using foreground elements out of focus to draw you in to the subject. Next up, it was time to photograph some bees. Now this is where the dual nano motors come into play because I will tell you that this is a super snappy, fast focusing lens on the R5, which means it's going to be the same type of focus on the R6 because it has the same exact focusing system. It is super fast and super snappy. So when you want it to get something in focus, it finds it and it goes there quickly. Or if you back focus, which I really didn't have an issue with here, it would miss or come all the way back quickly. Now I bring that up because I did test out the Nikon 105 macro at the same place photographing bees. I ended up getting some good bee shots, but I also realized how slow focusing that lens was. Now it was super accurate. I love the quality of the lens, but as we all know, the focus system on those Nikons is still pretty slow and basically outdated in comparison to what we're looking at right here. And that's evident if you pick up the Nikon and then pick up the Canon. You're like, wow, that's blazing lightning fast. So this lens is super fast focusing, and that's great when it comes to macro when you're hand holding, because the last thing I want to do is just like wait and wait, like come on, get in focus. And so he did that right here. Look how nice. Hi B, how are you? Are you enjoying all that nectar? Yes, thank you. Same, very similar shot next. I'm not sure which one was better. I think I may like the positioning of the bee here, but the colors, the tones, the clarity all look fantastic. Let me jump in here real quick and let you know that this video is brought to you by Squarespace. If you're looking to build your very own online portfolio, use what I use for jaredpolin.com because it's simple, easy, affordable, and I don't need to know coding. To get your 14-day free trial, head on over to squarespace.com/FroKnowsPhoto. If you decide that it's for you, use the code FroKnowsPhoto at checkout to get 10% off your first order. Now, let's get back to the video. We have a couple more landscape ones from Steven. This one, great composition. Love the out of focus foreground that draws you into the subject. So again, 100mm macro can also work out as a landscape lens. This is just to show you the lines. The lines are perfectly straight right here. They look great. This is the whispering eye, or the eye of Sauron. Colors are awesome. We got really super tight focus. What was this one shot at? This one was at f3.5, and that looks great. Then let's bring it back into the studio because I needed to test it out. I needed to use it a little more. So I broke out the 110-year-old typewriter and started to play around. Threw a light up there and then bam, look at that. Nice and close, really filling the frame well here. The details and the clarity are fantastic. And again, the focus was incredible because right before this, I was using the Nikon and it took me like 20 minutes to do what I wanted to do. And with the Canon, I picked it up with this lens and I was like done in 2 minutes, replicating the same thing because I didn't have to wait for focus. It was hunting quite a bit. I believe I'm focused on the 3/4 or the P. I may be on the P right here, but those are the hammers from the typewriter. This is the very tight focus you can see. Look at how narrow your depth of field is right here. It's running directly through the eye of the Nikon. I was typing Dear Nikon on the typewriter just to get some sample photos of something. And I love the 1:4, or not the 1:4, the 1.4 magnification just really brings you in just a little bit closer. Nice and sharp, nice and clean, and it's absolutely fantastic that way. So this lens is $1,399. For comparison purposes, it's $100 more than the old EF version, and it's also $400 more than what Nikon has in the 105 2.8. My question is, if we didn't have SA control, would we have saved $400 on the lens? I don't know, but who's it for? Look, if you're a professional, you shoot weddings, you have to get up and close and get details, then this lens is for you. It's like any lens. When you're a professional, you can afford it, and if it helps you get better results, then it's something that you might want to have in your arsenal. If you're just starting out and you haven't added the basic fundamental lenses to your kit yet, and you're not just focusing on macro type work, then this is a lens that's maybe the fourth or the third one, a specialty lens that you add a little later on, but it is an absolute fantastic lens. Love how fast it focuses, love how sharp it is, great colors, great tones. I wouldn't expect anything less from a lens like this. It is a great option to have if you have an EOS R style camera. But there are two more tests left. We've got the sniff test and the wind tunnel test. This time I want to do some wind tunnel tests. I'm gonna do a run and a jump, a hop and a skip, and hopefully not kill myself. A hop and a skip. That definitely passed the wind tunnel test. Now let's sniff it. Pansies. Smells like those flowers that are pansies. Pansy flowers. What a great smell. So is this lens for you? Let me know down below. Don't forget you can download sample raw files over on the website. Thank you very much for watching. Jared Polin, FroKnowsPhoto.com. See ya.